Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like worship your holy name. Bless you, time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship your holy name. Come on, bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship his holy. Worship your holy name. Lord, I worship your holy name. Sing like never. Worship your holy name.
A reading from Matthew's Gospel. The kingdom of heaven is like this. Once there was a man who went out early in the morning to hire some men to work in his vineyard. He agreed to pay them the regular wage, a silver coin a day, and he sent them to work in his vineyard. He went out again to the marketplace at 9 o'clock and saw some men standing there doing nothing, so he told them, "You also go and work in the vineyard, and I will pay you a fair wage." So they went. Then at 12 o'clock, and again at 3 o'clock, he did the same thing. It was nearly 5 o'clock when he went to the marketplace and saw some other men still standing there. "Why are you wasting the whole day here doing nothing?" he asked them. "No one hired us," they answered. "Well then, you go and work in the vineyard," he told them. When evening came, the owner told his foreman, "Call the workers and pay them their wages, starting with those who were hired last and ending with those who were hired first." The men who had begun to work at 5 o'clock were paid a silver coin each. So when the men who were first to be hired came to be paid, they thought they would get more. But they too were given a single silver coin. They took their money and started grumbling against the employer. "These men who were hired last worked only 1 hour," they said, "while we've put up with a whole day's work in the hot sun, yet you've paid them the same as you've paid us." "Listen, friend," the owner answered one of them, "I have not cheated you. After all, you agreed to do a day's work for 1 silver coin. Now take your pay and go home. I wanted to give this man who I hired last as much as I gave you. Don't I have the right to do as I wish with my own money? Or are you jealous because I am generous?" And Jesus concluded, "So those who are last will be first, and those who are first will be last."
There was once a time when farm workers, labourers and servants and some craftsmen would work for their employer from October to October. At the end of the employment, they would attend a mop fair, dressed in their Sunday best clothes and carrying an item signifying their trade. A servant with no particular skills would carry a mop head, hence the phrase mop fairs. Employers would move among these people discussing experience and terms, and once an agreement had been reached, the employer would give the employee a small token of money, and the employee would remove the item signifying their trade and wear bright ribbons to indicate that they'd been hired. They would then spend their token of money among the stalls set up at the fair, which would be selling food and drink and often games to play as well. Well, mop fairs are still held in some English towns today, although many have died out. Mops usually last for 2 days and take over the whole centre of the town, and in recent times mops have become little more than a fun fair. I think it's highly probable that similar fairs would have taken place here in Elstow, out there on the green. Although I can find no record of an actual mop fair, fairs continued to be held on Elstow Green until the 20th century. Sales of cattle ceased during the First World War, and from then on only a small pleasure fair continued until that ceased during the Second World War. Many festivals, however, continued even to this day. And there's a stump out on the green, which was the leftovers from the original medieval market cross, which denoted that Elstow had a royal charter status, so that it could hold fairs. That stump's still there today on the green. But today, well, look at all the queues in the job centres, and there's probably going to be a lot more too. The world which Jesus described in the parable of the labourers in the marketplace hasn't changed much. Anyone who's been unemployed, even if only briefly, knows what a blow it is to your self-esteem. Having to go cap in hand to people who are comfortably off, risking rejection, makes you feel undervalued, unworthy, and as though you've nothing to contribute to society. Jesus told a story about a most remarkable employer who took pity on the unemployed. And then he gave them a job even when it was almost sunset. And then he paid them a whole day's wages. The kingdom of heaven is like this, said Jesus. In other words, God's an equal opportunities employer. All are valuable in his sight. God has no favourites, and the heavenly reward he gives us at the end of the day depends neither on our background or how hard we've worked. The poor and the obscure are just as important to God as the rich and the famous. In heaven, Jesus said, the last will be first, and the first will be last. Well, when you understand this, the gospel message comes as a shock to people today. All people, it seems, today are interested in, if you judge by the adverts and the glossy magazines, is to be a millionaire or a celebrity or even both. Maybe even a YouTuber or an influencer. Now, I'm only beginning to understand what this terminology means myself. But what I do understand is that Jesus rose from the dead. We know this because he's alive and he answers our prayers. In the afterlife, says Jesus, all will be equal, and the unemployed and the rejected will receive exactly the same rewards as the people who look down their noses at them. Could we adjust human society to achieve equality on earth as it is in heaven? Well, in theory, according to the gospel precepts, all should receive equal pay. The ideal behind early socialism was from each according to his ability to each according to his need. But as soon as the communists tried to enforce this, they found it didn't work. The farmers won't till their fields, nor the factory workers increase their production unless they're paid more for doing so. As George Orwell pointed out in his novel Animal Farm, as soon as you arrive at a situation where all are equal, but some are more equal than others. So communism has either collapsed or been modified to embrace capitalism because it failed to deal with universal greed. It's often said that religion's the only thing that can change human nature. Now, I'm not going to discuss political theory here, you'll be pleased to know, but it does seem to me, by contrast, capitalism's built on inequality. People will work hard and seek positions of authority because it pays them to do so. And then it's hoped that those who have more money will invest it, reinvest it, in the wealth-creating industries, which will in turn produce more jobs and more income for the poor. But it doesn't seem to work that way. Once again, because the promoters of capitalism ignore the need for religion to limit people's greed. Now, don't get me wrong, some of the rich and famous do reinvest their wealth and give generously to charity. But many seem to live in obscene luxury. The gospel message today challenges us to honour everyone. Parents know their children are all different, with different talents and different abilities, but they struggle nonetheless to love them all equally. And that's how God loves us. And we must all try to build a society where even the poor and the poorly qualified are treated with respect. As the psalmist says, God's loving to everyone and his mercy is over all of his creation. That should be our target, as individuals and as a society. And remember, when nobody seems to love you or respect you, God's there beside you and God loves you. God knows that you're unique and that you have a unique contribution to make to the world around you. There are no unemployed in God's kingdom. Everyone's got a job to do and everyone will receive their heavenly reward. As for me, well, I've now got a job to finish off with me mop. Amen. Let us pray. O generous Christ, you are all and within all things, and all things come from you. You are the giver and the gift. Help us always to recognise your love for us without hesitation. Bless all employers with a spirit of fairness and grace. We remember all who have to queue for work, all who depend on social benefits. We pray for all who are without work, for those on low incomes, and those who cannot get work through prejudice. May all who prosper be generous and willing to share with the needy. God, who in generous mercy sent the Holy Spirit upon your church in the burning fire of your love, grant that your people may be fervent in the fellowship of the gospel, that always abiding in you, they may be found steadfast in faith and active in service. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, O Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and for ever. Amen. So remain in the peace of the Lord. Thanks be to God.